Hello, I'm Sue Romanoff from Edison Group. Today we're delving into immunotherapy, which is a really hot topic, and we're here with Jens Bjørheim, Chief Medical Officer from Ultimovacs. Welcome, Jens.
Thank you so much. Nice to be here.
Great. So, as a quick introduction, Ultimovacs is progressing a universal off-the-shelf oncology vaccine with its phase two clinical trials across five indications. My first question, Jens, is since nobody could possibly dose all patients with cancers at one time, there's a lot of statistical reporting that comes and it really muddies the water, I think. So without going into the established statistical models, could you help me understand the medical context for the phase two trial adjustments that we've seen?
Yes, absolutely. And I guess I should use Ultimovacs' own studies when I discussed it. Very shortly, so first in a phase one trial, you only add your drug to standard of care or test your drug as a monotherapy to see how the safety profile develops for the drug and also if there are signs of efficacy for the drug. Thereafter, in phase two, it's important that you test your drug against the standard of care in that indication. We always combine the vaccine with the checkpoint inhibitors in our randomized phase two trials. So it will be checkpoint inhibitor plus minus the UV1 vaccine on top. There are two things you need to consider. First, how much better will efficacy be for patients when you add your drug on top of the standard of care? You decide on a number. In our trials, we use hazard ratio and PFS, progression-free survival, as the primary endpoint. And in most of our trial, we have a hazard ratio of 0.6, meaning that the efficacy of the vaccine on top will lead to a hazard ratio of 0.6. And then the next question is, how sure will you be about the number you observe in your clinical trial when it's done? And then you use statistics to decide on the number of patients you need to include in the study, the inclusion time, and how many endpoints you will be waiting for before you have a readout of the trial. When you do have the results in your trial and you observe, for example, a hazard ratio 0.7, for example, then the question is, how sure can you be about this? In a phase two, you most likely will have an alpha of around one-sided 0.1 and a power of 80 in the study. That means that the observed number of 0.7, what you see, it's 80% likely that that is due to biology. So it's 20% chance that this was just random. And it's 20% chance that you didn't catch a biological effect of the vaccine. So it's 20% chance that the trial is negative, even if the vaccine has a positive contribution. So this uncertainty is something you often see in phase two trials, but this is the level you want to be on before you move on into a phase three trial. In the phase three trials, you will have tougher statistics leading to a situation where the statistics is done. You are 95% sure that what you observe is correct, and it's only a small chance that you won't catch a biological effect that is actually there. So why are we doing these different steps with the statistics? I would say that it saves time, it saves money, and it's ethical to do it on a smaller group of patients, not to expose several patients for the vaccine if it doesn't have efficacy. So this is the traditional way of moving a drug forward in clinical development.
So you touched on this a little bit. Like historically, PFS was the designated endpoint. But now overall survival seems to be the new goalpost, right? And why not? I mean, that's obviously the gold standard, what patients are striving for. Maybe you could touch on this a little bit.
Yes, so this is something also that is very connected to the phase two trials we just discussed. So of course, overall survival will always be the gold standard. You want to save the life of the patients so that they can move on. until maybe 10, 15 years back, it was not that likely that too many patients would survive a cancer indication in metastatic cancer. The investigators were focusing on progression-free survival, how to stop the development of the tumor for a while, and hopefully that would translate into overall survival for some patients. With the introduction of the checkpoint inhibitors, we have seen a shift here. For example, in indications like malignant melanoma, we can see that half of the patients are living for a very long time, 5-7 years, and most likely some of these patients are also cured. So survival for patients with metastatic cancer disease is not unlikely anymore. So why do PFS? As I said just recently, so PFS is a surrogate endpoint for overall survival. If you can establish an association between improved PFS and improved overall survival in the end, that is something that will save you money, time, number of patients you need in the study, etc. So it's a more efficient way to move a clinical program forward. it's not established PFS association with overall survival in all indications. In mesothelioma trial, as we just performed, we did not see a difference in the PFS between the arms, but we did see a 27% risk reduction for death. So in some indications, there will be established associations, and that can be used by companies to conduct more efficient trials, I would say.
So, in general, there are really strong opinions on vaccines, especially here in the US. And we see a lot of distinct approaches. What are the gives and takes, and how are you differentiated?
Yes, so we are working with a peptide-based vaccine. There are also other companies working with the RNA and DNA. The fact is that what you give in a vaccine needs to be translated into peptides or small proteins that are presented by the antigen-presenting cells to the immune system. So we give these peptides right away. With other modalities, you are giving mRNA or DNA that needs to be translated to peptides in the body and then presented by the antigen-presenting cells. So different methods to achieve the same goal. I do think that there will be several different methods that can manage to produce relevant T-cell or immune responses in patients with different modalities. For our vaccine especially, so we are targeting telomerase, and that's a self-antigen that is highly expressed in several cancer indications. In fact, between 85 and 90% of all cancers express telomerase. We do also think that there's a feature with the telomerase that is important, and that it is that it is a prerequisite for normal cells to develop into cancer cells. Telomerase is one of the hallmarks of cancer. It's one of the things that needs to be in place for a normal cell to develop into a cancer cell. So telomerase is giving the cells an opportunity for eternal cell division so that the normal cell that continuously develop into a cancer cell can continue to divide beyond what you see with a normal cell in the body. Also, since telomerase expression is a prerequisite for the cancer to develop, it will also be expressed throughout the course of the cancer from the early stages until late stage cancer. And it will also be expressed in all parts of the tumor, both in the primary tumor and in the metastasis. In early trials, in phase one, we analyzed immune responses from all patients in different indications. and we have followed these patients over several years. And we do see that the T cells recognizing telomerase is still around up to 7 years after vaccination. And this is because the telomerase is not changing over time. It's the same telomerase as day one. So you are in a way able to recognize the tumor over time with a vaccine like this. We also focus on the CD4 cells. So that will be the cells that in a way orchestrate the immune response. These CD4 cells, they will find telomerase in the tumor and in the draining lymph nodes and will remain there or stay there over time because they continuously discover new telomerase presented. And this will lead to a situation where the threshold for new immune responses is reduced so that there will be an antigen spread, new immune responses towards the tumor, facilitated by the CD4 cells and other things, of course, in the tumor.
Yeah, so that's actually super interesting. I think the other thing is, as a universal vaccine targeting, really with the objective of increasing accessibility, are there any gating factors to increasing the number of indications? I know you're already looking at 5, which is a lot, but are there any other gating factors?
Yeah, so it's general vaccine or universal vaccine in different aspects. So one thing first. So within the UV1 vaccine, there's a lot of epitopes, or that is small sequences that can be recognized by the immune system. So for many vaccines, you need to have specific tissue antigens, or HLA molecules, as they are called, for the vaccine to work. We do not do such analyses of the patients prior to use of the vaccine. We believe it's universal in that sense. So that means that you can use it across different territories in different indications. When it comes to the indications, we do believe that it's important to combine with checkpoint inhibitors. So we are now in 5 indications where the checkpoint inhibitors are either already approved or have shown signals of efficacy in that indication. So the target for us, the vaccine, is present in 85 to 90% of cancer. The checkpoints at the market at current will not cover all those indications. So hopefully over the next period of time, there will be development of even new immune therapy that can be combined with vaccines to help even more patients in the future.
So you have a lot going on. And so, but what should investors focus in on in the next 12 to 18 months?
We presented the first randomized trial was in mesothelioma. It was presented as a late-breaking abstract at the ESMO a few weeks back. Our sponsored indication or lead indication, malignant melanoma, will report first half of next year, more precisely in March, April next year for the primary endpoint data, and hopefully thereafter, all the data will be presented at an international conference. And we are really excited about this trial. So this is the INITIUM trial. It's in unresectable stage 3B to stage 4 patients. We combine with Ipi-Nivo, one of the standard of cares in that indication, randomized inclusion in US and in Europe. The trial was expected to have a readout first half of 23, but due to the lack of accrual of new endpoints, it's an endpoint-driven study, so we are waiting for 70 endpoints to occur. As of April and as of August this year, it has not happened. So in accordance or in discussions with the authorities, we have agreed to have a readout of this trial with a cutoff when all patients have been in a trial for 18 months. And that will happen in January next year. with the top line readout then in March, April, and thereafter presentation of the full data set at the conference. Also, next second half of next year, we will have a readout for head and neck cancer study. It's recurrent or metastatic head and neck cancer. Pembrolizumab plus minus the vaccine on top. So we really look forward to two data sets with the randomized data coming up next year for us.
Jens, it's always a pleasure to catch up with you. Thank you all for joining us here today. If you'd like to learn more about Ultimovacs, please refer to edisongroup.com. Thank you.